This is Dietmar Schauerhammer of the German Democratic Republic. He lives in Seoul with his wife and two daughters. His hobby is playing drums in a band. He is also one of the German Democratic Republic's greatest all-around athletes. A world-class performer, capable of making teams for both the Summer and Winter Olympics. Dietmar Schauerhammer was one of East Germany's hopes to win a medal in the decathlon at the 1980 Moscow Olympics. But severe injuries before the games prevented him from competing in the event eventually won by Great Britain's Daley Thompson.
I was very disappointed. Even more so when I realized it would be very difficult for me to return to a world-class level in decathlon. I enjoy my music as a hobby, but I needed the joy of the competition. The year after the Moscow Olympics, my good friend Wolfgang Hoppe, who also was a decathlete, suggested we try a new sport as a team. A winter sport. It was a very good decision.
Monday, February 22nd, 38 teams prepare for the fourth and final run in the two-man bobsled event. Leading to Calgary, the favorite was the number one team from the German Democratic Republic. Driver Wolfgang Hoppe and brakeman Dietmar Schauerhammer. In the 7 years since giving up the decathlon, Hoppe and Schauerhammer have become the greatest two-man bobsled team in the world. In Sarajevo, after winning the two-man event, they were joined by two teammates to win the gold medal in the four-man event. But as the Calgary Games approached, an injury to Wolfgang Hoppe caused a series of problems that jeopardized their chances of repeating as Olympic champions.
Because of Wolfgang's injury, he was not able to run at the start, perhaps the most critical part of the race. So we practiced the start with Wolfgang already sitting in the sled. I had two teammates to help me push off in the four-man, but in the two-man it became very difficult for me to push alone. This eventually led to an injury to my knee. When we arrived in Calgary, Wolfgang had almost fully recovered, but now the problem was with my injury.
A few days before the two-man competition, Dietmar Schauerhammer met with his friend Wolfgang Hoppe.
It was a very sad meeting. I told him that he would have a better chance of winning the gold medal if I was replaced. It was difficult for him to accept my decision because he knew we had been planning and training for this competition for 4 years. On a personal level, it also must have been difficult for Wolfgang because he felt responsible for my injury.
Now as the sleds go off in the final heat, Dietmar Schauerhammer must watch the race as a spectator. Wolfgang Hoppe and Bogdan Musil, Schauerhammer's replacement, are in second place, 77 hundredths of a second behind the number one team from the Soviet Union. They will go down the course before the team from the Soviet Union. In a sport where the difference between the gold and silver medals is decided by hundredths of a second, the Soviet lead is considered a comfortable one. Hoppe and his brakeman Musil get a fast start. The word brakeman is misleading, since it is illegal to use the brake until the sled has crossed the finish line. Hoppe turns in a magnificent run, but he knows that only a major mistake by the Soviet team will give him a chance at the gold medal. At The Soviet sled does not have to travel down the course faster than the East Germans. Rather, if they retain a part of their overall lead, the gold medal is theirs. At the finish of this final run, the Soviets are 6/100ths of a second slower than the East Germans. But their cumulative time of all four runs is still more than 2/3ths of a second faster than Hoppe's sled. Hoppe must settle for the silver medal. He congratulates Janis Kippers, the driver of the Soviet sled.
Immediately after the race, reporters asked me if Hoppe would have won had I not been injured. Well, I would like to think that people look upon the team's performance as important and glorious as if we actually had won. You must not forget that 2 weeks before the race, we did not know whether Wolfgang would be able to compete. In a sport where timing, teamwork, and practicing is essential, the second place finish should be honored, not questioned.
Five days later, 26 teams gather at Canada Olympic Park for the four-man bobsled competition. Again, there are four heats. Two today, two tomorrow. The team with the lowest cumulative time in all four heats is the winner of the gold medal. Much has changed since the bobsled competition was contested at the first Winter Olympics in 1924 in Chamonix. Then the teams were comprised of four or five men, and all of them were in the sled at the start. A restraining bar was released by an official, and the men bobbed back and forth to generate the speed that sent the sled down the course. Billy Fisk of the United States became the first bobsled superstar, driving to victory at both the 1928 and 1932 games. Today, Fisk's name remains in the record book, associated with two unique achievements. At the 1928 San Moritz Olympics, he was only 16 years old when he won his first gold medal, and today remains the youngest man to win at the Winter Games. 4 years later in Lake Placid, he won his second gold medal, and one of his team members set a record that still has not been equaled. Eddie Egan is the only athlete in Olympic history to win gold medals at both the Summer and Winter Games. At the 1920 Antwerp Games, Eddie Egan won the light heavyweight boxing championship. In the decades that followed, science and technology have contributed more to the development of bobsledding than in any other winter sport. The early sleds, made of wood, were driven with a steering wheel. Today, the sleds are aerodynamically designed, and the driver steers with cables controlling the front runners of the sled. In the early days, bobsledders were usually slow, heavy men selected for weight rather than athletic ability. Today, the crew members are fine athletes with speed, strength, and agility, for it is well known that the 50-meter run at the start is usually where the race is won or lost.
Of course, a good driver is important, and Wolfgang Hoppe is the best. But he cannot do it without the rest of the team having complete unity. Most people do not understand bobsledding. It is the trust we have in each other, and the harmony of the team to be as one. This can be the difference between hundreds of seconds, the difference between victory and defeat.
Sunday, February 28th, the final day of competition at the Calgary Games, and the last two runs of the four-man bobsled event. One day earlier, the first two heats were held. Then one of the most poignant moments of the games took place. Wolfgang Hoppe led his team to their starting position in his attempt to become only the third driver in history to win back-to-back gold medals. Joining him in the sled, his friend and teammate, Dietmar Schauerhammer.
There were 5 days between the two-man and four-man events. My knee had a chance to get stronger. A day or so before the four-man competition, Wolfgang said it would be very nice for the team if I were fit enough to join them. I thought for a moment and said, I think it will be all right. I took my position as a third man on the sled.
As the fourth and final heat gets underway, the East Germans are in second place, a good position to win the gold medal. They are only 1/16ths of a second behind the four-man team from Switzerland. The course, a little less than a mile, will take less than a minute, with the sleds running up to 125 kilometers per hour. There are 14 curves. Valuable hundredths of seconds can be lost if the sled takes a curve too high or too low. This time, 57.34, temporarily puts them into the lead.
Our final run was very good. We were all happy. But now there was nothing more we could do but wait. It would be about 20 minutes before the Swiss would make their final run.
It is now time for the Swiss team to move to the start. Their driver, 35-year-old Eckhard Fosser, who won the four-man world championships 5 years earlier. The Swiss do not have to go down faster than Hoppe's sled. They only have to be within 1/16ths of a second of the East Germans to win the gold medal. The Swiss start is near perfect. Now it is up to Eckhard Fosser and his teammates. The finish. They are 9/100ths of a second slower than the East Germans, but the gold medal is theirs. At the end of four runs, the Swiss have defeated the East Germans by 7/100ths of a second.
Who's to say where the competition was won and lost? We're talking about 7/100ths of a second, a blink of an eye. After it was over, Wolfgang and I talked. I thanked him for asking me to join the team. He looked at me and smiled. Then he said, "We've been together a long time. It is better to win a silver medal with you on the team than to win the gold without you."
This is Tomas Gustafson of Sweden. He spends much of his free time in solitude, writing poetry in the woods near his hometown of Eskilstuna. Tomas Gustafson is a national hero in Sweden, but he is not world-renowned. Nevertheless, Tomas Gustafson is one of the greatest champions in the history of the Olympic Winter Games.
Welcome to the Olympic Speed Skating Oval.
February 17th, 1988. the final of the men's 5,000 meters speed skating event at the Olympic Oval. Skating in the ninth heat, Tomas Gustafson of Sweden. He is defending Olympic champion. 4 years earlier in Sarajevo, he won the gold medal in this event and then went on to win the silver in the 10,000 meters. But for Tomas Gustafson, the four-year road to Calgary has been long and painful.
I won a gold and I won a silver, and I thought, well, the rest of life is taken care of. So right after Sarajevo, we had a world championships in Gothenburg, and I totally missed out. I was very disappointed about that. I told my sponsors the year before the Olympics, when I knew that the season was going to be nothing, I said, you don't have to pay me. You don't have to pay me the full sponsorship, because I'm not going to do anything.
Tomas Gustafson was depressed and despondent. Setback after setback followed. He suffered from meningitis and could not train or compete. Then the saddest moment of his life, the death of his beloved father.
From the beginning, he was always at the ice rink watching me train. Like, I could ask him to drive 250, 300 kilometers just to sharpen my skates at a very inconvenient time, and he would come. He always backed me up. He is everything. So everything was minus points. My father died, I had a meningitis, I was sick, I didn't have any motivation. I was really feeling bad. My life didn't take me anywhere.
But soon Tomas Gustafson knew he must try again. For himself, his father, and his country. Though he had won a gold and silver medal in Sarajevo, he must start all over again for Calgary.
I just felt it inside that I had something that I wanted to bring out. So I slowly got the motivation, and I thought, I'm going to go for Calgary.
For Tomas Gustafson, the plan was simple: to go back to where it all began.
I knew that the only place in the world, really, where I could pick up the inspiration to go through with my plan, that was to be in the woods, where I've done everything before. Like, my boyhood was in the woods, not downtown, but in the woods, because every tree is talking to me, every rock is telling a story in a way.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Calgary. February 17, 1988, the final of the 5,000 meters. 12 and one-half times around the 400-meter course. Tomas Gustafson will skate in the ninth out of 16 races. This is a fortunate position. All of the other top contenders will skate before him. Nevertheless, Gustafson arrives on the ice just a little before his race. He does not want to be affected by the performances of his major opposition.
I come out on the ice 10 minutes before my race. I don't think about a race. I think about running in the woods. I think about being out here. And I try to bring the good feelings I always feel out here.
In the second heat, Leo Visser, one of the favorites from the Netherlands, sets an Olympic record and goes into the lead.
Visser's time of 6 minutes, 44.98 seconds places him in first place.
In the third heat, Geir Karlstad of Norway in the red uniform, who created the world record here at the Olympic Oval 2 months earlier, starts quickly. Karlstad is magnificent during the first half of the race, but he tires badly. He finishes almost 6 seconds behind Leo Visser's time and is all but out of contention for a medal. Now, the fourth heat. Gerard Kempkers of the Netherlands, Leo Visser's teammate. His time is 9/10 of a second slower than Visser's, but good enough for second place at this early stage of the competition. The heats continue, but no one is fast enough to take over the lead from the two Dutch skaters. Now it is time for Tomas Gustafson. He is paired with Munehisa Koroiwa of Japan in the black uniform. But in reality, the only opponent Tomas Gustafson has is the clock. Lap by lap goes by. Though he doesn't have the fastest time at the halfway point, Tomas Gustafson is confident.
I knew that I could skate what the other people had done because I knew the results. It didn't matter how they had done it, but I knew that I could do it. I had the whole race clear for myself, but not to the finish line, but to two laps to go, because two laps to go, I knew if I was within 1 second, I could make it.
With two laps to go, Tomas Gustafson has slightly miscalculated. He's a little more than a second behind the time of Leo Visser, the leader. With one lap to go, Gustafson is still 8 tenths of a second behind. Coming off the final turn, Gustafson is not certain he has made up the deficit. Although there are seven more heats, there is no one who can challenge his time. The gold medal is his. Days later, the final of the 10,000 meters, 25 times around the Olympic oval. Once again, the luck of the draw has given Tomas Gustafson a favorable position. He will skate in the ninth heat. Again, as in the 5,000 meters, all his major opposition will skate before him. He will know the time he will have to beat. In the fourth heat, Leo Visser turns in a commendable time to temporarily take the lead. But in the fifth heat, Mihail Hajchief of Austria skates more than 4 seconds faster to go into first place.
Mihail Hajchief's time, 13:56.11 seconds. A new Olympic record placed
in the sixth heat, Geir Karlstad of Norway falls and is out of the race. Karlstad, the world record holder, was the first man to skate the distance under 14 minutes. Now, in the ninth heat, Tomas Gustafson begins in the outside lane. His partner, Roland Fryer of the German Democratic Republic. In the first 400 meters, Tomas Gustafson gives strong indication of what is to come. His time is the fastest of all.
Tomas Gustafson split 1:09.24.
As the laps go by, he increases his margin.
2:16.26+. That's 2.75 seconds faster.
It is apparent that only a fall can prevent Tomas Gustafson from his goal.
He's on a world record pace.
Now the 25th and final lap. Tomas Gustafson has won his second gold medal and creates a world record.
My whole life flashed through my mind, and I was just extremely happy. That was the dream I had, skating when I was 4 years old, together with my dad. It's something that is indescribable, standing there and thinking about everything that has been. And you can do that in just a few moments. Seeing the Swedish flag race, it's beautiful.